Good morning.
Good morning.
Good to see each and every one of you today. Let's all stand, if you would. Hymn number 330, Amazing Grace. Let's all stand.
Teams are having our training this evening. Now, looking out, I would imagine that there are a bit more than 100 people here in this room. So I know one thing, at least one thing to be true, is that at least 100 people in this room are called to missions. That may not be overseas missions, but I know that it is sharing the gospel with others. Now, you may say, well, Taylor, say yes. You may say, I don't think that I need to be a part of a gospel conversation team, what even is that anyway, in order to share the gospel. And you are correct. But I invite you to think about when the last time you shared the full gospel, the point of decision was with another person. When was the last time? And also, would you rather share the gospel on your own, not surrounded by other people or prayer, or would you rather be a part of these teams that are going to go out together, and we're going to have training this evening, and you're going to have all kinds of people praying for you? And my guess is that you would rather share the gospel in that circumstance than just on your own. So I am giving all of you the opportunity to come this evening to be a part of the gospel conversation teams. You can sign up on the bulletin board outside. But you don't have to sign up to come. We just kind of want to know a number, kind of where we're at, how many we might have going out. This evening, we are not going out. We're not talking to anybody if you don't want to. But we are going to kind of learn about our plan of attack. How are we going to approach the houses around Calvary with the gospel? What's the most effective way that we can use? How can we as a church effectively grow the kingdom of God, not for our own sake, but for the glory of God? And before I tell you just a little bit more, Haley is going to kind of give you a sneak peek of what we are doing this evening. So I'm going to have Haley come up, and she's going to come around to this whiteboard.
Okay, this is a method called the three circles that I'm going to show you. It helps you share the gospel. The world is broken. And we all know that that is not God's design. And because the world is broken because Adam and Eve sinned, and the world fell from God's design into brokenness. And people try to get out of that brokenness by, say, relationships, religion, but they still get back into God's design. They still don't get back into God's design. It leads them right back into brokenness. And to get out of that brokenness, God sent Jesus to die on the cross for us, and through repentance and faith, Jesus went into the brokenness, and he brought us out of it, and through repentance and faith, we can get back into God's design. And the last part is, since we're back in God's design, he requires us to go back into the brokenness and share the gospel.
Let me brag on Haley for just a second. If you know Haley, you know that she is a little bit shy, and I think she would admit that too. But one of Haley's goals, once she graduates high school, is to go to Midwestern and to go through the Fusion program in order to train how to be a missionary, making part of her life's work to be to share the gospel with people who do not know Christ. And that's not because Haley naturally wants to do that, but because Haley knows that God's call on her life is more important than her own shyness or outgoingness, whatever it may be. And so Haley enjoys sharing Christ with others, and I've really enjoyed seeing Haley come out of that shell in order to share the gospel with other people. So I'm thankful for the work that God is doing in Haley and in our youth, and I would love to see that in your lives as well. It is an intimidating thing sometimes. Sometimes it's awkward to knock on doors, share the gospel. Sometimes it's awkward to make phone calls and share the gospel. But none of that should stand in the way of God's call on our life. And so I would really, really encourage you. We are doing the method that she just showed. I will go over that in great detail this evening at 5 p.m. And I will show you some good suggestions on what we might say when we get to the door, what we might do if they respond one way or another. And so I want to equip you all, the church, in order to do God's work, missions. And so I would invite you to be there at 5 p.m. this evening, and we'll go through training, and then every Monday, including tomorrow, we're going to meet together in order to grow the kingdom of God. So I hope that you would be a part of that.
Where will we meet tonight?
We will meet most likely in the fellowship hall. But if all of you come, which I hope is the case, we'll meet right here, and that'll be just fine, too. All right? But as we continue in worship, would you pray with me? God, I thank you for who you are. I thank you that you have chosen sinners like us to be a part of your big and glorious plan. Lord, you have given us not only the opportunity, but the joy to serve you. Not just me, not just Pastor Don, not just Michael, or any individual specifically, but all of us as a church, Lord, you have placed a call on us to fulfill your work. And part of that is sharing the gospel. So, Lord, would you give us boldness? Would you get rid of all of our anxieties, all of our worries? May we cast them on you, as your word says, so that we can bring glory to you through sharing the gospel in your word. Lord, I pray that as we go through service this morning, that you would be with us, that you would be here as your word says you will be. And would you open up our hard and callous hearts to hear your message? Lord, we want to be faithful to you. So help us to get rid of all distractions, to focus on your word, but not leave your word here, but take it with us so that we may apply your word this week. It is in your name that we pray. Amen.
I don't know that I've ever said anything about our church singing in corporate worship, how important that is. We have a singing church. Now, you all may individually may not want to go up and sing a solo up here, but when it's corporate worship time, you're all pretty much, all of you, participating. I read an article this week said that most churches, about 40% of the people in congregation sing. And a lot of them kind of sing like they would if they were singing in an elevator. Na, 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 standing on the promise. You're not really singing out. Most of you sing out. And I just want you to know I appreciate that. And I'm sure the Lord appreciates that. And there's something about corporate worship. That's one of the reasons I wanted to let us sing even without the instruments. I love having the instruments play, and the ladies do such a wonderful job. But every once in a while, just hearing the voices only is a whole different experience. And so I want you to challenge yourself that if you have been singing out a little bit, sing out a little bit more. If you've been singing out a lot, sing out a lot more. If you've not been singing at all, give it a shot. It won't hurt. We go to the doctor and we don't like to do that. But you'll begin to like it, I promise. There's just something about being part of the corporate worship. And I want to invite you all to be more and more involved in that. And the Lord be glorified for it. Let's continue our worship. 335, standing on the promises. And as David Green says, we're going to stand on our blessed assurance as we stand on the promises.
Standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing.
Doesn't the choir look good this morning? And you know there are about seven more seats in the choir.
They're getting ready for Palm Sunday. They're going to do a special musical program, and they're going to do two-thirds of the service, and I'm going to preach the other third. And they could use some more folks. So if you're ever thinking about joining the choir, if you like to make a joyful noise, they're going to practice today, right after the service today. If you want to stay behind for a little while and practice with them, Chris, how's that for advertisement?
Yes.
All right. And Chris texted me yesterday and said, Pastor, we need to promote the choir, get more people in the choir. Thank you for your passion for that, Chris. I want to say something about prayer for just a moment. 1 month from now, we'll be in revival. We'll have a revival on Saturday night, the 22nd, on Sunday morning, the 23rd. And we need to pray for God to bring revival. Now, what is revival? Revival is when God gets a hold of his people in such a way that they can't do anything else but be obedient to him. That's what we want to see God do. Revival first starts in the church, and then it spreads to the community. Now, what Taylor's doing is helping us to think more about the community, but we need to think about praying for our church family, too. So the deacons and staff and I are asking you to join us for 12 hours of prayer, March 31st and April 1st. We'll start at 7 o'clock at night and go till 7 in the morning. There's a sign-up sheet in the hallway. We really believe in signing up around here. So when you're signing up for Taylor's class tonight, sign up for the prayer time. And I don't mind if you need to sign up for those 7, 8, 9. And if you can't come here to pray, you can pray at home. Just put home next to your name. But we will have somebody on the premises all night long. Either a deacon, a staff member, will be here all night long as we pray for revival. Half an hour increments. Let me encourage you to do just that. This morning we're going to pray. And I want to lift up especially this morning Debbie Davis's brother, who Don Nichols, who is at University Hospital. I saw him yesterday. Debbie, he was talking real good, and still got that knot on his head, and he's got a blood infection that they're treating with antibiotics, and they're hoping, and his wife is advocating for him to get back in Rusk Rehabilitative Rehab. And that would be the best thing for him. We hope that happens in a few days. I don't know how long the IV has to work toward the healing there. But I got to see him, and then I got a text from my brother, who's the pastor, First Baptist Stover. They had to take his wife to the hospital emergency room this morning because her incision from her back surgery was leaking. They believe she has an infection, and they're taking her to University Hospital today from Bothwell, and then put it on top of that, pray for me. I'm taking my brother to university tomorrow morning for a scheduled catheterization on his heart. So pray for him. They're sure having a lot on their family. And I do believe that when we have a lot come on us, we have a bigger God than anything that comes on us. I believe that. In fact, how many of you were here the other night for David Ring's message? You were here? For those of you that are here, I want to hear you tell me in three words, what is your story? What is your story?
I am blessed.
That's right. I am blessed. What a story. But we all have it. If that's not your story, and if you have no idea what we're talking about, go online and watch most of David Ring's message. Thanks to Donna. She recorded everything up to about 5 minutes before the invitation. And then the battery ran out on the camera because he talked for an hour and 25 minutes. I'm going to take his lead this morning, and I'm going to preach for that long, I think. And I know you all leave. But seriously, what a wonderful message you gave for us the other night. Let's remember that as we pray. I am blessed. Would you pray with me? Just in your own heart and mind right now, would you just ask God? Ask God, what is it he wants you to do to have an impact on someone else? Either someone else who's a member of our church, to get them to come back, or someone who ought to be in church, and maybe they're a believer, maybe they're not. Would you pray for that person or those persons right now? Would you pray that God would convict them of their need of Christ or of their need to get back to Christ? Father, I come to you in Jesus' name today, and I pray for revival. We know that revival doesn't come in the suitcase of the evangelist. We know that it doesn't come from the message of someone outside of the church or inside of the church. But that revival is when the Holy Spirit gets a hold of God's people and they begin to be obedient through the supernatural power of God in such a way that our behavior in the church will have such a great impact on the behavior of those outside of the church that they'll come to Jesus and also become a part of what you're doing in kingdom work through this church. God, I pray that revival would happen in such a way that it'll change habits, it'll change our behavior, it'll change our whole outlook on you, Lord. We depend upon you, Lord. Oh yes, we're depending upon you to get to heaven, and we know we're going because we're standing on the promises and because of your amazing grace, but God, help us to depend upon you more. I pray for some folks this morning that are especially hurting. Lord, I lift up the Nichols family. And I thank you so much for Don and Joyce, and I pray this morning, God, that you would touch and heal Don's body, that this infection would be cleared up quickly, that he can move forward in his recovery. We thank you for what you have done in his life, but we pray for that complete recovery, that you give his dear wife a special portion of your strength as she walks by her husband's side in this recovery period. And I will lift up Melody, my sister-in-law, this morning with the possible infection. I just pray that you would touch and heal her, and that the fix for this won't be too difficult, that they would trust you. And I pray for my brother Ron as he goes for this heart cath, and I pray that he can get, if necessary, a stent, and it won't go any further than that. I just pray you touch and heal him. And Lord, I pray for tonight. I pray that you would convince and convict those in the church that ought to be here for the training to come. We will be blessed because we're better equipped to go and share Jesus with others. Now I pray for the remainder of this service that you'll be pleased through all that is said and done at Calvary. We'll give you the praise and the honor and the glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Blessed assurance. Just happy accident, I guess. I will let you remain seated. 334 blessed assurance.
Thank you. pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this moisture we got this morning. We needed that. Thank you very much. We thank you for this congregation. I ask that you please bless Pastor Don today as he delivers the message. And Lord Jesus, we just thank you for loving us so much that you shed your blood for us to pay our sin debt, to give us salvation. And as we collect this offering, we ask that you please bless the gift and the giver. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Accompanying her, and I will say this, that Donna's the singer, and we are the doo-woppers. So here we go.
I chose a song that's a really old song, pulled it out of the archives. Taylor, it's got country gospel, but sometimes we have to take the salt with the pepper. So, and I just thank these faithful servants who really didn't know the song that well, but if in about 15 minutes... I'm flying through whether they do or not.
There's the door right there.
That would be so bad.
Love on his face, turning.
Tammy, why not? That was great, Donna. Thank you. That's an oldie but goodie. Amen?
Amen.
The gospel's called good news, isn't it? That's actually what gospel means, is good news. But if I was to stand up here today, like some preachers will in some places, and tell you a list of rules that you had to keep to get to heaven, that would not be good news. In fact, if there were 10 rules you had to keep to be sure that you were going to heaven, would you make it? Just think about that for a moment. I want to give you a little test. It's not hard. I want to ask you a few questions. How many here have never told a lie in your entire life? Not one little tiny white lie. Oh, put George's hand down. I'm telling you what. So as far as I can tell, besides George, everyone in the room has told a lie before. Okay? Now, some people lie all the time. But all people lie sometimes. Sometimes the lie is the lie you tell yourself. You say, I'm going to stop this, or I'm going to start this, or I'm going to do this, and then you don't do it. How many of you have never stolen anything in your entire life? I mean, a nickel or a dime, a piece of bubble gum, an answer off of somebody's test. I wasn't really cheating. I was checking to see if they had it right. You've never stolen anything in your entire life. Now, George is an exception here. Anybody else? Oh, come on, Marty. Your hand will run off. Okay. I can go on. In fact, I'll go on just a little bit. How many have never been angry with someone? Angry with someone. Never been angry. There might be somebody else. And why do I say angry? Because I expect in this crowd, if I was to say how many of you have never killed anyone, a lot of you could raise your hand. I hope so. In fact, if you kept your hand down, I'd be a little concerned about you. But Jesus said if you hate someone in your heart, you've murdered them. You've already killed them. Well, that's 3 of the 10 commandments. I could go on. You want me to? Yeah. No, I'm not going to go on. But I'm going to say this. Watch out for your wallets and your purses, because you're in a room with a bunch of liars and thieves. You know, we can't be perfect on our own. Not a soul here. And I want to remind the wives, your husband can't be perfect on his own. Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
None of us are perfect. But turn in your Bibles today to Romans chapter 3, because as we enter God's courtroom, it's getting pretty convicting for all of us. This morning, we're going to look at the purpose of the law. And as we read from God's holy and inspired word, I'm glad that we stood on standing on the promises, because it's hard to be standing on the promises when you're sitting on the premises. We need to stand. But I'm going to ask you to stand one more time as we read from God's holy and inspired word. Romans chapter 3, beginning with verse 19. Now we know that whatever the law says, it says to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be silenced and the whole world held accountable to God. Therefore, no one will be declared righteous in his sight by observing the law. Rather, it is through the law that we become conscious of sin. But now a righteousness from God, which is apart from the law, has been made known, to which the law and the prophets bear witness or testify. This righteousness from God comes through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. There is no difference, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and are justified freely by His grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. God presented Him, Jesus, sacrifice of atonement through faith in His blood. He did this to demonstrate His justice because in His forbearance, He had left the sins committed beforehand unpunished. He did it to demonstrate His justice at the present time, so as to be just and the one who justifies those who have faith in Jesus. Where then is boasting? It is excluded. On what principle? On that of observing the law? No. But on that of faith. For we maintain that a man is justified by faith apart from observing the law. Is God the God of the Jews only? Is He not also the God of the Gentiles? Yes, of the Gentiles too, since there is only one God who will justify the circumcised by faith and the uncircumcised through that same faith. Do we then nullify the law by this faith? Not at all. Rather, we uphold the law. May God add His blessings to the reading, the hearing, and the understanding of His word. Thank you. You may be seated. In verses 13 through 16, the writer of Romans, God is the author. Paul was the human secretary to write these words down. Describes verses 13 through 16 the sinfulness of man. Now, just a few moments ago, by keeping your hands down, you all admitted, I'm a liar. I'm a thief. I've been angry. Like I said, that's just three of the Ten Commandments. Why did He give the Ten Commandments? He gave the Ten Commandments to describe the sinfulness of man. I've got news for you today that if you don't think you're a sinner, you can't be saved in that condition. If you're not willing this morning to admit that you're lost and undone and do not have a relationship with God through the law because of your deeds, we're all in the same boat, folks. We're all lost. He says it like this in 13 through 16. Their throats are open graves. Their tongues practice deceit. The poison of vipers is on their lips. That's pretty serious, isn't it? Their mouths are full of cursing and bitterness. And by the way, don't we see that in the world so many times? How many times do you go to work or you go to school and all you hear is the foul language and the nastiness of others? We hear a lot today about bullying, and many of you have been bullied, and some of you have been bullies. But all that is people just spouting hatred towards someone else. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Ruin and misery mark their ways. That's the world we live in, folks. That actually is us. We are these kinds of sinners, the sinfulness of man. Psalms chapter 5 and verse 9, describing the sinfulness of man, says, not a word from their mouth can be trusted. Their heart is filled with destruction. Their throat is an open grave, and with their tongue they speak deceit. That's a perfect illustration of politicians in Washington, D.C. Amen? Doesn't it just sound like that? And then Psalms chapter 10 and verse 7, his mouth is full of curses and lies and threats. Trouble and evil are under his tongue. He's talking about the corruption of the heart of man. There's no good in man. We are no good. You say, oh, Pastor, that doesn't make me feel very good. Good. I'm not trying to make you feel very good. I'm trying to help you see we are all sinners. Even the sweetest grandmother in this place today, and there are a lot of sweet grandmothers, you're a sinner too. We're all sinners. Then he says, Romans 3:17, and the way of peace they have not known. I want you to be convicted of your sin. We must be convicted of our sin. But I'm not trying to make you feel bad. I'm really trying to make you feel like you know that you're a sinner. And one of the disadvantages of not knowing Jesus, if there's anyone here that's not sure that Jesus is your Savior, is you haven't known the way of peace. And if there's something that everybody's looking for peace. I don't know anybody that wants to always be in conflict and in trouble and difficulty. In Isaiah chapter 59, verses 7 and 8, the Word of God says their feet rush into sin. They're swift to shed innocent blood. Their thoughts are evil thoughts. Ruin and destruction mark their ways. And here he gives that same word that's in Romans, the way of peace they do not know. And by the way, the reason they don't know the way of peace is they don't know the Prince of Peace, who's Jesus. There's no justice in their paths. They have turned them into crooked roads. No one who walks in them will know peace. Look at verse 18 of Romans chapter 3. There is no fear of God before their eyes. If there's something that everybody in this room has in common, I want to tell you what it is. One day, every one of us will die unless Jesus comes first. Now, personally, I'm looking for the upper taker and not the undertaker. I would rather go up than be put in the ground. It really doesn't matter what they do with my body after I die, because the Bible says, absent from the body, present with the Lord. Amen?
Amen?
But the other thing that we all have in common is this statement right here. We will all stand before God in judgment. Everybody on the face of this earth, unless Jesus comes first, will die, and they'll stand before God. And the question is, what will you say to Almighty God? If God was to ask you this question, why should I let you into my heaven, what would you say? Some of you would say, well, I baked cookies and gave them to the Meals on Wheels program so they could give them away. And the great ham and beans. Anybody get ham and beans yesterday? Weren't they good? Some of you don't know what I'm talking about. If you didn't get it, you should have. You had to buy those. But you say, well, I even once a month I go out and deliver the meals. And I go and visit the sick, and I volunteer at the church. If there's ever a piece of trash on the property, I pick it up. And you're just making a list of all the good things you do. And God says, well, whoopee doopee. It ain't that great. You're a sinner. And we stand before God condemned. Unless we know Jesus. Unless we know the way of peace. There is no fear of God. See, that's the world we live in. They don't believe that God's going to judge them. They don't even believe that God exists. Now, can you believe there are people that don't believe that God exists? I just read this statistic yesterday. That in 1996, there were 4% of Americans who said they didn't believe in God. And that between 1996 to the year 2016, that number increased to 14% of Americans who say they don't believe in God. Let me tell you this, it takes a whole lot of faith to be an atheist. You said, what? It takes a whole lot of faith to be an atheist, because you have to be able to say, I've been everywhere, I've seen everything, and I know that God doesn't exist. It's a lot more honest to be an agnostic. Anybody ever meet an agnostic before? Some of you have. Do you know what the word agnostic means? It means without knowledge. Without knowledge. So the next time someone, a friend of yours or relative, says, I'm an agnostic, look at them and say, I can tell. That's a joke. At least the agnostic is saying, I'm not sure whether there's a God or not. That's a more honest evaluation. But for that person that says, I know that God doesn't exist, how can they know that? But this is what God says. We're all in the same boat. He says, now we know that whatever the law says, it says to those who are under the law, so that every mouth can be silenced And the whole world can be accountable to God because we're all going to stand before God in judgment. And all of us stand before Him. 1 Corinthians 14, 21 says, and the law is written, through men of strange tongues and through the lips of foreigners I will speak to this people, but even then they will not listen to me, says the Lord. It's interesting. The law is given to show us that we're sinners, yet some people aren't even going to believe what God says. Verse 20 says, of Romans 3, therefore no one will be declared righteous in his sight by observing the law. Rather, through the law, we have become conscious of sin. Is there anybody in the room today that didn't look in the mirror when you woke up this morning? Anyone that did not look in the mirror? I don't see anyone. Maybe George didn't look in the mirror. I'm not sure. But his parents looked at his face to make sure that, yeah, he was ready and fixed his hair. This child has so much hair. I think that must have come from you, Taylor. I'm not sure. But this is the deal. We all looked in the mirror this morning. Why did we do that? Well, if you're Merlin or me, we didn't look to fix our hair, did we, Merlin? We didn't have to fix our hair. But we maybe looked at ourselves. Some of you spent a long time in front of the mirror. Some of you, like me, said, that's the best I can do and left after a couple of minutes. The law is like the mirror that you look in every day before you go out. It shows you what you're like. How many people here this morning took the mirror off the wall to clean your face? No. And it's the same thing God is saying is, don't take the law and expect it to clean you up. Look at the law and let it show you what you have done wrong. The law is a mirror showing us our sin. Look at this verse from Galatians 3:24. So the law was put in charge to lead us to Christ, that we might be justified by works, right? No. Look at that. In fact, would you read that verse off the screen with me? So the law was put in charge to lead us to Christ, that we might be justified by our works. Oh, does it say that? Let's do that again. So the law was put in charge to lead us to Christ, that we might be justified by faith. That's how we're saved, folks. We're saved by faith. And we're saved by faith in Jesus. Look at verse 21. Because righteousness apart from the law must be made known. He said this in verse 21. But now there's a righteousness from God, which is apart from the law, because there really is no righteousness in the law, and it has been made known, to which the law and the prophets have testified. And we see several verses about this. Isaiah 46 and verse 13, the prophet said, I am bringing my righteousness near. It is not far away. My salvation will not be delayed. I will grant salvation to Zion, my splendor to Israel. Jeremiah chapter 23 and verse 6, he says, in these days, Judah will be saved and Israel will live in safety. This is the name by which he will be called. He will be called the Lord our righteousness. This is the deal, folks. We can't be righteousness on our own. We can't get righteousness on our own. The Lord is our righteousness. He took our place so that we could live. Acts 10:43 says all the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him, now this is it, everyone who believes, notice it doesn't say everyone who behaves, it doesn't say everyone who keeps the law, but everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. Folks, righteousness only comes one way. This is so important. This is why there was a reformation. This is why Martin Luther put the 95 points on the Wittenberg door 500 years ago. This is why. This righteousness from God comes through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. There is no difference. You know how we judge people? We judge people by how they Do you know how God judges people? God judges us by what we believe. Because our belief, if it's a genuine belief, now listen to me carefully, if it's a genuine belief, if it's a sincere belief, our belief will affect our behavior. And if you have said, I have believed, and your behavior hasn't changed, you better check and see whether you really have belief. I can't be your judge. God is your judge. But you have to judge yourself. And then that very important verse that's a part of the Romans Road that we love to quote, and it's important. We are all in the same boat. We are all sinners in need of a Savior. Amen?
Amen.
For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. So he says this, verse 24 through 26, that he says, not only have all of us sinned, but we are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus, because God presented him, Christ, as a sacrifice of atonement through faith in his blood. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus through the sacrifice of his blood. He did this to demonstrate his justice, because in his forbearance he had left the sins committed beforehand and unpunished. And he did it to demonstrate his justice at the present time, so as to be just and the one who justifies those who have faith in Jesus. God's plan is for all men's sin to be paid for by Jesus. We are judicially justified. Here we are in the courtroom. I'm giving you the evidence from God's word. We are judicially justified by faith in Jesus Christ alone. By faith alone, in Christ alone, on Christ, the solid rock, I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground. And my favorite verse, one of my favorite verses in all of the New Testament, it is by grace we are saved through what?
Faith.
And this is not from ourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works. The next verse says, then Titus 2:11 says, for the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men. And then Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 7, he says, it's in him, in Christ, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of his sins in accordance with the riches of God's grace. For by grace, there's no room for boasting. There's no room for boasting. Verses 27 through 29 says, where then is boasting? See, if we were saved by singing a song, Michael might be saved. Maybe Donna would be saved. But singing a song doesn't get us saved. Singing in the choir doesn't get us saved. Giving a tithe of what God has given us back to him, that doesn't save us. No, there's no boasting. It is excluded. On what principle? On that observing the law? No, but on that of faith. For we maintain, Paul says, that a man is justified by faith apart from observing the law. Is God the God of the Jews only? No, he is not the God of is he not also the God of the Gentiles? Yes, of the Gentiles too, there is no boasting, because Ephesians 2:9 says, it's not by works, so that no one can boast. Nobody here. What a great job, Haley. Where'd Haley go? What a great job you did with the three circles this morning. I'm so glad you connected that last circle. That's pretty important. What a great way to tell the story of Jesus. That we live in a broken world and we're separated from God because we are broken. And there's only one who can bring us into a state of unbrokenness, and that's Jesus, when we come to him by repentance and faith. That's it. It's such a simple story. It's not by works. It's by grace. So, verses 30, 31. purpose of the law shows us that we are all sinners in need of a Savior. Since there's only one God who will justify the circumcised by faith and the uncircumcised through that same faith, do we then nullify the law by this faith? No, not at all. Rather, we uphold the law because the purpose of the law was fulfilled in showing us that we are all sinners in need of a Savior. So you know what? Every one of us needs the same thing. Every one of us needs to call upon the name of the Lord Jesus to save us. And every one of us can take this simple message, the message of, later we'll look in the book of Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. The bad news, we're sinners. The good news, God wants to save us. That's the message of God's grace. That's why we know and are convinced that we're sinners. The question is, are you convinced today that you need a Savior? And I know many, many here today. I can't see your heart. I don't know your condition with God. I see by your works many of you are walking with God, and I believe that you are certainly Christians. But there might be one here today. You might have been faking it, or maybe you've been trying to earn it. God says it's by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone. Place your faith in Christ. And if you say, well, I know that, Pastor, then I hope that your faith has been strengthened today to go out and tell someone else, hey, we live in a broken world. Wouldn't you like to let Jesus fix what's broken in you? That's all we're doing. I had a dear friend. He is a dear friend. He's 81 years old. Preachers around the world still. Dr. J. Gordon Henry. And he said this to me so many, many years ago. He said, evangelism is simply one beggar telling another beggar where to find bread. That's all it is. One beggar telling another beggar where to find bread. Would you pray? Our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed. God gave us the law to show us that we're sinners and point us to a Savior. If you're here this morning, and you're not absolutely sure, you know that you're a sinner, you're convinced of that, but you're not absolutely sure that you're saved, and you want that Savior today, you don't have to walk an aisle, you don't have to raise a hand, you don't have to be baptized. None of those things can save you. But what you have to do is you have to call upon Jesus. And if you realize you're a sinner in need of a Savior today, and you know your need to call on Jesus right now, would you call out to Him? Would you say, God, I know I'm a sinner. I'm willing right now to repent of my sin and turn from my sin and myself and trust in Jesus Christ as the only one who can pay for my sin. I'm turning to Calvary today, knowing now that Jesus died in my place, and that He is the only way I can get to heaven. If that's the prayer of your heart today, you've never trusted in Christ alone, would you do that right now with heads bowed and eyes closed? I don't know if there's one like that here today or not. But if there is, would you lift up your hand and put it back down and say, Pastor, pray for me. I want to turn from my sin and myself and trust in Christ today. Is there one all across the congregation? I may not see your hand, but God sees your heart. God bless you. Anyone else? Just lift up your hand and put it back down saying, that's me, Pastor. I want to know that Jesus is my Savior. Thank you. Anybody else? I want to put my faith and trust in Him. It's not about what we do for God. It's how we place our faith in Jesus. Is there someone else? And maybe you're here today and you say, I know that, Pastor. But I need to start telling others about it. I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand. I'm going to ask you to sign your name on that list in the hallway saying, I'll be here for the gospel conversation team training. Don't raise your hand. Show us, show Taylor, show me, that you're willing to to at least learn how to communicate this faith. Father, I pray this morning for this invitation that you would draw those to yourself that need to come. Some may need to come to the altar this morning because they're convicted of how they need to tell others about the grace of God and how it's by grace alone, through faith alone, and Christ alone. Help them to come and pray for the people on their list that they're trying to bring to Christ into the church. Help them, Lord, to be obedient to you in whatever you've called them to do. For that one that needs to publicly profess Christ as Savior and follow you in believer's baptism, help them to be obedient to you. That doesn't get them saved, that's just the next step in being obedient to you. And I pray that many will today make that decision that they want to begin to share this message of grace. Draw those to yourself that you would draw in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to stand and sing our hymn of invitation. You step out of the aisle. If God has spoken to your heart today, you're in the heart of God. You come right now. You come.
Here. If you need to sit down in the chair, you're strong enough. Okay. All right. Praise God. Let's sing a song. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. God bless you.
I'm so glad.
I'll see you.